उनको करें, हमारे हमें हाल पर छोड़ दिया जाए। कश्मीर एक आज़ाद खित्ता था, 16 अगस्त 1947 को जब पाकिस्तान और हिंदुस्तान मध्य वजूद में आए, उस वक्त कश्मीर एक आज़ाद रियासत थी और हम चाहते हैं कि उस आज़ाद रियासत को कायम किया जाए। सिर्फ आज़ाद रियासत के बलबूते पर हिंदुस्तान और पाकिस्तान आपस में जंगें ना करें, आपस में नफरतें ना बढ़ाएं, अमन और प्यार और शांति से रहें और हमें हमारा हकूक दिया जाए।
So what is the current economic situation in Pakistan occupied Kashmir today, sir?
It's not better than what is Indian occupied Kashmir. It's more or less the same. Neither Indian occupied Kashmir, neither Pakistan occupied, both are economically worse at the moment because both countries are putting money actually on arms and forces. And that's what we don't need. What we need is the basic rights. So they can give their own population their basic needs, their basic requirements. More than 25% of population of India and Pakistan lives under poverty at the moment, below poverty line. So what we are saying, please don't spend money on arms. Please don't spend money on forces actually. Spend money on the basic needs of the people of India and Pakistan and let Kashmiri live for their own peace.
Why is the army of Pakistan refusing to leave POK? Because it's called Pakistan occupied Kashmir. They've illegally occupied it. So why is it refusing to leave?
Actually, it's exactly the same thing. Indian occupied Kashmir is illegally occupied. Pakistani occupied Kashmir is
the Jammu and Kashmir is actually part and parcel of India. It is not illegally occupied.
You are saying, but we are not saying.
Well, if you look at the UN resolution,
Kashmiri have the only right to decide about their future. Neither India, neither Pakistan have the right to decide about the future of Kashmir. So that's what I'm saying. Both are occupied countries. Both are occupied states.
And how free are the elections in POK?
I mean, you can understand. I mean, people are saying the election of Pakistan is not free. Actually, so how it can be free in Pakistani occupied Kashmir?
And why is Gilgit-Baltistan taking part in the protests now, which was seen as part of Kashmir?
They are. Gilgit-Baltistan is also part of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So they are exactly in the same situation as the so-called Azad Kashmir. So there is no difference between that.
And
both countries are occupied actually.
And how long are you going to continue with these demonstrations out here?
We will continue as long as it's no point of just sitting here and then continue our transmission. Our demand is very, very simple. That India should go back to their own borders, Pakistan should go back to their own borders, leave Kashmiris actually to decide about their own future.
And today you're going to pass on some kind of agenda onto the Pakistan.
It's actually a resolution which we are going to give and pass over to the Pakistan embassy.
And has there been any solutions from them with regards to the previous resolutions that you've handed over to them?
There is no resolution. We are not interested in any you. If you're talking about UN resolution, we're not interested.
But with regards to your demands, has there been any reaction from them?
Not at all. Not at all. Neither it happened in the past, and we can't see actually in the future as well. But because we are occupied, so we have to carry on our demand. We're asking all over the world actually that please help us, because unless they don't sort out the Kashmir issue, they won't get a peace actually in that part of the world.
And do you think the world is listening?
World can only listen if you get an oil actually in Kashmir. Unfortunately, it isn't at the moment.
So how long do you think you will carry on?
With the Kashmiris is also. Some of them actually demand, actually they want to be part of India, some of them want to be part of Pakistan, and some want to be independent. And that is the division within the Kashmiris itself. And that is the biggest problem for the Kashmiris.
So you will be here back in time and again with these protests?
Every time actually there is anything happened actually in Kashmir, we will be here.
Why have you joined this demonstration?
I came in touch with some of the representatives from Pakistani occupied Kashmir and got an understanding of the gravity of the situation on that side and how the human rights situation is and how it's being abused and what the democratic process is actually for them, which is effectively the absence of democratic process. This is the reason some of us took a stand, and we thought it would be a good idea to support these gentlemen here and give them strength as much as we can, because it's a just cause, as India has been asking, that the rights of people in the Pakistani occupied Kashmir have been compromised, which is what, as an Indian, I'm taking a stand here. Yes.
And How many of you are here today?
It's between 8 and 10 people, some of us, yes.
So what do you make of the situation at the moment? I believe that the cleansing among terrorists has started in Kashmir, and the separatist's son, Gilani's son, has now been arrested.
I believe the situation is quite sensitive even now because of the unrest that has been supported, unfortunately, from across the border, and the unrest that's being fueled by a small group of separatists. That situation needs to be controlled there so that the life can go back to normal. Obviously, the people are suffering because of that. It's from what I'm reading in the media, it's the children who are suffering. They cannot attend their schools and colleges. The people don't have food supplies, etc. They can't go out because of some of the separatists who have called for the Bandh across the small region of Kashmir. But hopefully, we are quite hopeful that the situation will improve and the security forces are, and the government there is doing their best to improve the situation.
What is your view of the economic situation in POK? Because you are from Jammu and Kashmir itself, but are Hindu.
I believe the economic situation obviously needs a lot of improvement. Again, my understanding on the side of POK is what I've read and talking to some of the gentlemen here. It does need a lot of investment, which is not happening. It does need a lot of job creation, which is not happening. There is absence of democratic process, which obviously needs to change. There is, again, this farce called the CPEC, China-Pak Economic Corridor, which is effectively an attempt to take away the rights of the local people there. So that all needs to change. Otherwise, the situation is definitely not going to improve.
But yeah. CPAC is having an impact on Balochistan, Gilgit, which is the Gwadia port. So the impact on Kashmir, how do you see that?
I think it will be a wider impact. The way the natural resources of this area are going to be taken away from the people, and from what I've read in the media, not the local people who are getting the job, but it's the people being brought in from outside the region being given the job. That's not fair to the local people.
And so you just mentioned that the situation in POK is bad economically. Is it as bad as that in Jammu and Kashmir?
From what I've read, statistically, last year's budget of Jammu and Kashmir state, just the state government's budget, was 65,000 crores, in the range of 65,000 crores, and that doesn't include the national projects being implemented. So, to me, it doesn't look like the situation is definitely as bad. The situation is far better economically and financially. The security situation in that small part of the valley will hopefully improve soon, and we will see the economic positive effects of that. Yes.
I mean, according to UN, it's POK, Pakistan occupied Kashmir, which is illegal, and therefore the Pakistani army is there illegally, and Jammu and Kashmir is not, as far as my understanding goes from the UN.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. I think until and unless Pakistan takes away their army and removes them, their security forces from their occupied region. And freeze up that region so that it can be integrated with India, which is what the resolution and which is what happened as part of the accession. There is unfortunately going to be a pretty bleak future for that region, which is Pakistani occupied Kashmir.
And according to the UN, the resolution says unless Pakistan takes a step out of Kashmir, then there will be India will come out and they will.
Absolutely. I mean, until unless Pakistan decides to remove their forces from that area and freeze up the people, there cannot be a positive economic and secure future for the people there. And I mean, it has to be the region is supposed to be and has to be part of the integrated Jammu and Kashmir, which is an integral part of India. That is what we look forward to. Yes.
And are you going to continue with these supports with these groups now?
We'll continue to support these gentlemen here. They have a just demand that the Pakistani forces should be removed from their area. So we will continue support these gentlemen. Yes, absolutely.
Thank you for talking.
I am from Srinagar. My interest in this is I have been in this country for many years. I'm the chairman of Jammu and Kashmir Peace Committee and have been involved in Kashmir affairs since decades in this country. we set up this Kashmir Peace Committee in 90s when there was problem in Kashmir. Basically, our principle is that Jammu and Kashmir cannot be dissolved by militancy at all. I have been in demonstration all over here, but basic fact remains that Jammu and Kashmir is divided between India and Pakistan. And it is sad that we can't get regional peace in this place. My more interest in today's demonstration is 22nd of October. I was a small little kid in Srinagar. I have got still very, very vivid memories of the attack that Kabbalis, what we call them, have attacked. And literally from my house, we could see the Kabbalis coming and the bombing going on there. So I have got that still memories of that attack that Kabbalis had. Then of course the whole thing has happened. And
when was that? Which
year? 1947. October 22nd of 1947. I'm not young, but I still have the young memories of those things. But coming back to realities of life, I've been invited into Pakistan 2 times. I've been involved, I have visited Azad Kashmir as the government guest. I have seen all these things, both sides. I go to Kashmir, I've got a house there, I live there. I was in October last year there. But most important thing is that we are not going to solve the Kashmir the last 70 years by shouting and demonstrating and accusing each other. The only way is to have peaceful negotiation between India and Pakistan and involving Kashmir.
But there's a lot of cross-border terrorism going on, and they keep breaking the ceasefire militancies from that side every now and there, and the Indian army is forced to go there and protect its land.
Yes, I know it has happened more recently, but these are only symptoms of what the problems are. We're not really going to the deep problems of things. I think Prime Minister Modi has done excellent start with, but unfortunately things have not worked out as he would have liked. But again, with all these things that's happening, I still stand firmly that there is no solution between India and Pakistan unless to live together, as the Prime Minister Bajpayee has also mentioned. We need to coolly think rather than try to accuse each other. I have been watching Pakistan channels, I have been watching Indian channels. It's very sad what is happening, but that is not the solution.
And how worried are you that there's likely to be a war between India and Pakistan with regards to the Kashmir issue now?
Not at all. I'm not worried at all. There will be never, never a war between India and Pakistan, especially the nuclear bomb, because both countries are very aware, and I'm quite confident of leadership of both countries.
But Pakistan has threatened India that it can throw a nuclear weapon, and now it's also said that Israel, we can wipe you out in 12 minutes. That's the latest threat from Pakistan.
Yeah, but that is, that in reality, it will not happen. Even today, if the choice is given to America to bomb Japan in Hiroshima, they will not do it. That is the situation of the facts. 50 years back, what happened? They had about, America has got bombed, Russia has got bombed. They never used those banks. So don't let us not deceive ourselves that India will going to bomb Pakistan or Pakistan is going to bomb.
India's not going to in any way. No. But with regards to this demonstrations, how long do you think you're prepared to continue to see a peaceful solution there?
No, it just depends upon the people, really. I being an Indian myself, of course, I've got all, but I have lived in Azad Kashmir as well as a child. My father was there. So I have got a lot of...
So you said you've been to Azad Kashmir, yes. and they say Azad Kashmir, but it's not free at all.
No.
It's Pakistan-occupied Kashmir.
No, it is right, but that you may be thinking, but they think that it is free for them. So we should accept it. We should accept the international border and this ceasefire line. That is the only way out. That should be the border between what is Azad Kashmir and what is our part of Kashmir.
And why? So, and why is the army, Pakistani army, refusing to leave?
Well, this is the same thing. As I said, I'm talking to the same position. We have to look into deeper things. Because if the relationship between India and Pakistan are not good, these are trivial matters at the bottom. Okay. Armies can't do anything. You know, they are told what the political leaders are saying. But unfortunately, in Pakistan, it's the army which is having the strong, you know, hold on the situation. So, but, you know, one has to face this. But I don't accept what is happening in India and Pakistan relation at all. And I think it's wrong, and I condemn it.
Basically, as you know, 22nd of October 1947, the Pakistani army forces and the other peoples which they organized to capture my country, Jammu Kashmir, they entered in Kashmir and they brutally killed thousands of people and they gave a chance to India and Maharaja gave accession to India. And that was a day, black day. We think that's a black day in Kashmir history to capture our country.
Do you think the Greater Kashmir, which was, you know, the boundaries of India, were all the way up to Afghanistan, was the best part of a united Kashmir then?
Of course, we would like to get a united Kashmir, and that's a solution for South Asia, for peace in South Asia. If Kashmir become a united Kashmir, so the India and Pakistan, they don't have any dispute and any tension. They don't need any army in India and in Pakistan. Of course, there isn't any issue in between them. And the people of South Asia, they can live peacefully without Kashmir problem. And Kashmir solution is the only solution in South Asia for peace is a Kashmir, for a free Kashmir.
But there's problems in Pakistan with regard to the Baluchis, the Sindhis, the Gilgit-Baltistanis, and... The Sindhis, they're all demonstrating against Pakistan to get freedom from Pakistan as well, and Baluchistan seems to be a big issue now.
Of course, all nations, they're demanding for their rights, and it's their right to get their freedom. And if they don't want to live in that confederation, so it's their right to get separate. Otherwise, if they force them to get them in that unity, so I don't think so they can run peacefully.
And what do you feel about the cross-border terrorism that continues?
We condemn that, and it's not a solution of Kashmir, and Kashmir is not a only Muslim religion territory. It's a multi-religious territory, and the all peoples who live in Kashmir, rather than it's a Muslims, a Hindu, Sikh, Dogra, Buddhist, everyone's a Kashmiri. So it's not a only Muslims issue, it's a Kashmir issue.
And you're going to continue with these demonstrations for as long as you live?
Yes, of course.
Well, I represent Kashmir National Party, and of course other parties have also joined us in demonstration. And this demonstration was to protest against Pakistani unprovoked attack on the state of Jammu Kashmir, which started on 22nd of October 1947. All the problems which we face today on both sides of the divide, line of control, we strongly feel that that is because of that unprovoked attack on the state of Jammu Kashmir, which was managed, controlled, and directed by Pakistani army and tribesmen from northwest frontier. And Pakistani officers in civilian clothes were controlling and managing that invasion. Unfortunately, that was done in name of Islam and Jihad. In actual fact, whatever they did was against Islam and against the rules of jihad. They killed innocent people, they raped women, kidnapped women, and also they did that by violating a valid treaty called standstill agreement, which was concluded between Maharaja of Jammu Kashmir and the government of Pakistan. So first they violated the treaty, second they attacked us, thirdly they again, as I said, committed inhuman atrocities, and they looted and plundered our area, and they continue to do it. And sad thing is the Pakistani obsession to capture Srinagar or Jammu and Kashmir by force has not, you know, ended. They have not abandoned their policy. They still, you know, sending jihadi forces armed with weapons and manipulated in the name of religion to go across and commit atrocities, and they are saying this is jihad. This is not jihad, and they are creating problems for us. And what we say to them is, please, you resolve your own issues. You have plenty of issues in Pakistan, in Balochistan, in Swat, KPK, in many other parts of country, Karachi. Why don't you pay attention on those areas? And if you're so concerned about the welfare of the people of Jammu and Kashmir, why not give fundamental rights to people of Gilgit-Baltistan or Pakistani-occupied Kashmir? We are also citizens of Jammu and Kashmir. Why is it that you value more to the people of those who are under the Indian occupation or under on the other side of the line of control? We say we are equal citizens. We have the same rights. Just because we are under your control, does that mean that we do not deserve to be free? Does it mean that we cannot enjoy the fruits of democracy and fundamental human rights? So this is the hypocrisy of Pakistani rulers, and we strongly protest against it.
It says Azad Kashmir, but it's Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and the army is illegally occupying that part of that, and they're refusing to leave.
One Balochi leader came to one of our functions. He said there are around 200 independent countries. Have you seen anywhere written independent Germany, independent Britain, independent America, independent Australia? Why is it that there is an independent name, independent prefix with Kashmir, Azad Kashmir? And then he says, people of Kashmir, Azad Kashmir, think there's something wrong. It means you are not Azad, you are not independent. They are just fooling you. They're just fooling you in name of Islam, and that you are Azad. You are not Azad. We are occupied. We are occupied territory, and we are denied our fundamental rights. And if we speak now, especially now with the CPAC and the National Action Plan, they can take anyone away. They say anyone who criticizes CPAC, that person, you know, there could be issues with the sedition. People are issued sedition charges. Many people who are locked up are taken away, and they disappeared from earth just because they have raised their voice against CPAC.
The Baluchis have suffered a lot, you know, over 21,000 people have been killed, disappeared, and they've been also using chemical weapons on the Baluchis.
Well, during a last session of the United Nations Human Rights Council in Geneva, I was there, and I was among those who listened to the speech of Khan of Cloth. Really impressed, and the details he gave us about what is happening to people of Balochistan, it was really horrifying. And I cannot imagine that one human being doing this to another, especially when they claim to be Muslims and say that what they're doing is in the name of Islam. It was tragic, and those people are suffering. And I think all those people who believe in humanity and equal rights should speak out against it.
Today, I've heard reports that cleansing amongst the terrorists in Kashmir has begun, with the separatist Gilani's son has been arrested.
Well, I have not read about it. I heard about it. I don't know why he was arrested, but my point here is that government of India has been treating these separatists in murdered coma like royalties. I don't know why they're treated as a special people, why certain rules and regulations are not applicable to these people, why these people are given Z plus security. I do not know. If Gilani's son has been arrested, I want to know why he's been arrested, what has he done, And if he has been doing this some time ago, or he's been doing this in the past, and other youth leaders have been doing these things in the past, why they were not arrested, why they were not charged, why now?
Reports also claim that America has warned Pakistan that if they do not destroy their terror networks, that they will have to deal with them. You know, they have to destroy their terror networks.
Well, Pakistanis are saying there are no terrorist infrastructure, there are no outfits there. But of course, there are no terrorist outfits there. They are jihadi outfits, but they have different names. So jihadi infrastructure is intact, and they are fully operating. And then they're making excuses that we are fighting against terrorism.
Osama bin Laden was found in the backyard.
Well, he was also a jihadi, so he was okay. Maybe many others, you know, you can name. I can give you half dozen names, maybe more, who were wanted people, who were known terrorists, and they were caught from Pakistan. But because they don't regard them as terrorists. To them, they are jihadis and they're promoting a Pakistani policy. And there's a foreign policy tools, strategic assets. Who wants to destroy their strategic assets?
And now Pakistan has issued a warning to Israel, saying they will destroy them in 12 minutes. How far are they willing to go?
Well, with nuclear weapons? Do you know any country with nuclear weapons threatening like this? We can destroy New Delhi in so many minutes and destroy Israel with so many minutes? Is that a logical thing? Can any sane people issue those statements? But I don't know what they were trying to do. And then sometimes I wonder, are they going to continue blackmailing people? If you don't do this, we are going to use nuclear weapons. For how long people and the world community and countries in the region will put up with this pressure, put up with this blackmailing? This has to end.
And how worried are you there's likely to be a war between India and Pakistan?
Of course, we are extremely worried, because war is not the way forward. And if there is a war, I know that J&K will be the battleground. They will fight inside J&K. And of course, our people suffer, and I don't want suffering. I don't want Indian people to die. I don't want Pakistanis to die. War is not the way forward. It will create more problems, not only for people of Jammu and Kashmir, but for people of Pakistan and for people of India as well. War, as I said, must stop. And the Pakistanis and Indians need to sit down around the table with people of J&K and resolve these issues.
Sir, petition.
Thank you very much.
So nice of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.